most of my work is gone. Wyman was the guy who spotted creative interchange. The idea that people need to interact in an authentic way to appreciatively understand one another so they can creatively integrate their differences and their similarities to invent ways that we continuously learn together. Good idea for husbands and wives, good idea for parents and children, good idea when working with colleagues, a good idea for a lot of things. My job that I picked up on in 1966, though, was to look at what has to go on inside here for that to happen. How do we create that context? It was there in the infant. It was there in the small, small child. But somewhere it got messed up. So, one of the first things is a child was born aware, but yet not fully, quote, conscious. I want you to make that distinction. Bear with me for the rest of the day. I'm going to suggest there's two parts of you. They're not two different things. They're the same thing under different conditions. You were born aware, but mommy and daddy started to take that awareness, if you will, and shape it into a form of consciousness, that you should be conscious not to throw your food on the floor, because mama is tired of cleaning it up. And so she begins to steer, if you will, that awareness in saying that when you're in this context with food on your high chair, don't take it from there and test gravity to see if it will fall on the floor each time. Now, I do admire the scientific part of the kid who said, well, just because I dropped it yesterday, maybe it goes another direction today. That's a kid who's got curiosity, pain in the butt for mom and dad, but a kid who clearly is interested in seeing how the world works. But eventually, you better learn to keep an eye on your tray, or there will be some consequences. So, we're going to look at and hopefully experience the difference today between awareness and the part of you that does a lot of what we're going to call self-talking. So I'm going to talk about two parts of you, awareness and consciousness. Wyman called them your creative self and your created self. There is a creative part of me that is not confined to any one version of me. So there's a part of you that's been created, and the sad part of it is most of us identify with a current version of ourselves, never realizing I can generate another version of myself. Totally oblivious that that was possible. And to that I turn to the educators. Isn't it wonderful that his hand went up at exactly the right time? Because they're the ones who begin to help us shape this consciousness.
I was just wondering, Charlie, is that similar to the concept or the notion that Jung called pre-personality, personality, transpersonality?
Ooh, that's good. Say it again. That's kind of sexy the way you said that.
Thank you.
Is everybody familiar with what he just said?
No. Jung, well, Carl Jung calls this the pre-personality, and then everybody in that process of created self, he calls it the personality, which comes from Greek persona, which means mask in Greek. And then, of course, when you're able to blend those two into a new kind of identity, personality, he calls that trans-personality.
Follow that? Any questions to challenge Ram here? Make him feel inadequate? You would let us make
try, guys.
Yeah, try to make him feel inadequate. Yeah, literally it's that idea. You have a thing called awareness, but then we begin to shape it into a persona, a mask, a personality, which is what Wyman meant by the created self. And you need to hang on to that last thought, because we'll wrestle with that this afternoon.
What's the difference between teachers and facilitators?
I wish there were one, but. Hopefully, well, I think teachers are moving more toward facilitating, aren't they? More. Mm-hmm. That it isn't my job just to stand up and tell you what the right answers are. Part of it is for you to discover from within yourself that learning happens. You know, are you familiar with the word educate? It means to draw out. It does not mean to pour in. Okay. But you see, we create the created self usually by pouring things in and then demanding that you better follow these rules or there will be consequences you have to pay if you step outside them.
Well, that's an interesting point we get here too, and I can only talk about it in terms of a paradox, because a lot of teachers strongly believe that you need a certain type of knowledge at the first hand, and then skills, and then a number of attitudes, but in first hand you need knowledge to be able to make your own learning. And is that, of course, the how our educating system has evolved from since Enlightenment, that you first need that knowledge to, and there they make the mistake that they only have to pour in. I think you need to be able, you're pouring in now as well, but we'll have to recalibrate that into our own personal situation and then make meaning of it. And that's the part, in my experience, is that most teachers forget, is that they keep pouring in. But I think the pouring in needs to happen as well, at first, or not.
Oh, I think some of it does, but it doesn't have to be done at the expense.
Yeah.
It doesn't have to be done at the expense. You start out aware, you can learn to be conscious and still be aware. We do not teach children that. We teach them that you move from whatever this pre-consciousness is, that consciousness is the whole ball of wax. We've got a charter school, an experimental school in Nashville now, that is trying to teach kids so-called mindfulness. They came in the world mindful. Then we gradually get them out of their mind in order to fit in. But they're teaching, working with five-year-olds in kindergarten, to be aware, self-aware. That's what we want to talk about this afternoon in more detail. Instead of being so self-conscious, I want to help you to get back in touch with being more self-aware. You can still remain self-conscious, but you need to be more self-aware. And we'll look at the difference between the two later. But the idea is the consciousness side is where you do all the talking to yourself. That's the internal dialogue. That's the conversation you hold daily. It's also the part of you that you think is who you are. Well, I'm a business person, or I'm a musician, or I'm a good husband, or I'm a bread provider, or I like spinach.
I'm a teacher.
It doesn't make any difference what it is. That's the personality that you have evolved. Yes. You talk to me?
No.
Don't you know there are consequences? You were talking in the class?
Yeah.
Do you not know what teachers would do with that?
That's the F of the test.
Charlie, I wanted your attention.
You too?
Yeah. Because you said that people of Belgium, they talk a lot of languages, etc. The problem with awareness and consciousness in the beginnings was that if you translate it into Dutch, it is bewustzijn. Yeah. Both. Mm. Yes. So therefore I jump in. My understanding is that awareness is uncolored. Bewustzijn. Niet gekleurd. Naked. See it as it is. That's why you see observing. Whenever we observe something, we try to color it, to make sense of it, and it becomes conscious. The great learning here is that we are born aware. And you can see it in children. They are observing purely. afterwards we are start coloring. Judging. That makes sense to me. Hasn't to make sense to you, but awareness is pure. It's light. Pure white light has all the colors. And we use the prism or whatever to make our... So that's the difference. So sorry about that, but I had enormously difficulties to understand it, and I spare your time. You don't have the time anymore to struggle with it. Think of naked consciousness and colored consciousness. Sorry about that, Charlie.
If I prefer naked to color, what does that say about me?
That you're a human.
So, to build on what Johann just said, if we think about awareness is there in its purity, but each of us have, through conditioning, through mom and dad and education, we've created a little kind of prism, and it's created a certain set of colors. All of them are still available, but we basically only see the light coming through our filters. Are you with me with that? Mm-hmm. That the filters are the created self. But the awareness is still there in the background. The simple message of this whole day would be, the more you can close your filters for a while and experience more of the white light, you can then, you get material to start changing the hue, the strength, the colors, the shades, and you can do something different with your own mind. You with me? And we all have that capacity. A child, who we often talk about, uses imagination, which is one of the first things that formal educators wipe out of children, is their capacity to be imaginative. When they play the game of what if, just suppose, I wish, how to. We think we must have the answers or we're going to flunk the test, and if we flunk the test, we're in big trouble. We do not know how to work with a child. But I was going to tell you about these five-year-olds. One of the five-year-olds who's being taught to stay in touch with their awareness. He was talking about his little brother. And he came home one day after school. When the brothers were together, they played together, had all kinds of fun together. But he found his little brother had gotten his toys out while he was still at school. And so he got very angry, but he came back to school the next day and he described to his teacher, he said, I saw him with my toys and I normally, he shouldn't be in my room. And then I realized I was getting mad at him. And so I stopped and I thought, well, I let him play with him every other time. And he told his teacher how he walked through the very thing that we would hope you could walk through before the day is over, and he changed it and let his brother play with it and decided he was no longer mad at him. Otherwise, he would just come home, snatch the toys back, maybe punch his brother in the face or whatever he might do, and tromp off. But he had already been trained to realize that was his prism or his persona was reacting. And he was able to see the difference in the two. And they also worked with the parents in the school. And one of the mothers said about her five-year-old in kindergarten, she said the other day she had really gotten upset, you know, out of control. My kid's doing something I don't want. And the little kid sat up to, he looked up in her face, he said, Mommy, breathe. Breathe, Mommy. He already knew she was losing control. Already losing control. The child was helping her get back. All I'm saying is we still have that capacity. That's where our freedom can actually work. I assume in your country, we used to say, if you're really upset with somebody, count to 10 before you do anything. You have that notion? It's that idea, except it's stronger than that idea. It's literally moving inside yourself and letting the chemicals disperse. intentionally. Part of what was happening when you counted to 10, the chemicals were starting to disperse somewhat, and you were less prone to scream back. But the issue is, you can make a choice about how much of that chemistry gets loose in your body, okay? The issue is then, what we want to look at is appreciation. We want to discover you have an intrinsic worth. The one that I told you is always there. And you've got an extrinsic worth. That's the one where everybody applauds, accepts, and says you're just the greatest thing that's ever been. And you feel so good, and all they've done is say your shirt doesn't have any wrinkles in it or something. Can you imagine people being upset because somebody didn't like the color of your shirt? Some people can go crazy over the fact you didn't think my clothes were appropriate in a given situation. So, the other thing I want you to work on this afternoon is there's a positive and potential negative in anything. And get used to practicing that and realizing I've jumped to the negative, there is a positive, or I've jumped all the way to the positive and there may be some potential negatives. And if you go too much positive, you many times get hit with unintended consequences. Oh, we didn't know that was going to happen. Well, the issue is you might have known had you not gotten so excited about doing what you were going to do that you forgot to ask some alternative questions. Notice the one is observing, the other is, quote, perceiving. You both, most of our time is spent over here perceiving. What we want to do in teaching you mindfulness is to get you back observing. Now, for those of you that took science in school, you remember them talking about being, quote, objective? What do they mean by the word objective? Why is a scientist supposed to be objective? What's that mean?
To be able to be verified.
Say it again.
To be able to be verified by other people.
Okay.
Verification is a very...
So part of objectivity is if you look at something and see something, I look at it and I see the same thing. Mm-hmm. Okay.
Based on facts. Mm-hmm.
Okay. The idea was is that we screw up facts, right? We have a tendency to be, quote, subjective. Yeah. I give them an interpretation or a meaning, and I find out, well, I guess we have a number of police officers with us today who can say that at a scene of a crime and you got witnesses, sometimes the stories vary. Well, what you have are different interpretations of the events seen from different perspectives. And so, if you say, well, now what were the real facts? Well, maybe it was somewhere in between. Or maybe they were both crazy. You never know. What we want to look at also is the way you think. This is what that other one was about. Most of us have been trained to think in a linear, logical pattern. And we say facts are based on certain kinds of linear logic or validation of other people. And so people who think in a non-linear way, we call them artists, psychologists, or who knows, whatever we call them. But you see, the human brain is capable of both. But if you use it only to the exclusion of the one, that means that where the non-linear colors would come through on your prism, they don't come through. They've been blocked out, right? We get to what we would call the ability to operate inside ambiguity and spontaneity. A small child was born into an ambiguous world. They didn't know what any of it meant until somebody started teaching them what it meant. But if you get an adult and you create an uncertain situation, most of them start to get uneasy very quick. What are they afraid of? Why would the unknown be so fearful? And part of it is, quote, I might get hurt. I might look stupid. I might not be the head of the class. Okay? So we want to look at that process. And finally, continual transforming takes motivation. Motivation of your willingness. If you see something you want to do differently, guess what? you're going to have to practice. You don't become a professional dancer, singer, athlete, police officer, or anything else without a lot of practice. Nobody's good on day one. It takes time. How many times have you had a New Year's resolution? Maybe it was about a diet, maybe it was about a new habit, or I'm going to work out in the gym, etc. And it lasted, that's been calibrated. Most of those are over by February 14th. They fade. In other words, the discipline to do it, the same way with creative interchange. If you're going to get back to something that's innate in you, when you have this years and years of habit over here, those habits are not going to disappear unless you choose that. We know from neuroscience, if you quit using a pattern, it will begin to dissolve. You've heard the statement, use it or lose it. That's valid. If you don't keep running, if you keep doing what you always did, you'll keep getting what you always got. And of course, you're kind of half crazy if you keep doing the same thing, wishing you get something different, and it doesn't change, so you try it again. You can go on and on and on forever that way. So the issue is you have to have the patience to be willing to really practice. You have to be willing to act on it and to learn and behave it. You have to be willing to risk it. And that's where most people are scared to death. You mean, if I want somebody to be vulnerable with me, I ought to be vulnerable with them? And the answer is yes. In fact, if you're the boss, who's going to fire you? So you, of all people, can afford to be vulnerable. It's the poor peon that just got a job 2 weeks ago that was scared to death because I might lose his job. The very people who could most afford to take the risk are the ones most fearful of taking it. Check that out and see what your self-talk is telling you now. Because it's contrary to popular thought. So if we put all this, if we put the first two together, we get trusting and respecting. I'll trust you with the best of me, and I'm going to respect the best in you. It's built on intrinsic worth, that I'm no better than you are. And you're no better than I am when it comes to our intrinsic worth. You may be smarter, higher IQ, you may play the piano better. That's not the whole reason I respect you. I'm impressed that you can do that. And I'll applaud for you if you really are good. But that isn't where your true value as a human being comes. Okay? So if you imagine a team of players, the team you work with, your colleagues, what's our trust level? And how much do we truly respect the other, even if they made a mistake? Your intrinsic worth is not based on whether you make a mistake or succeed every time. Your intrinsic worth is there. Why? Because you're intrinsically valuable as a human being. And only you can judge yourself negatively and go down the wrong path. So the key is to stay away from there, okay? What you also get from the second one is you can do divergent thinking. You can welcome new ideas, new ways of looking, alternative perspectives. It isn't just about my way or the highway or the right way. It's saying together we've got a better way than me by myself. When we look at the cognition and we change it, we can do what we call converging and inventing. We can take ideas that seem at first to be opposites, ideas that seem to be at war, and we can figure out ways to put them together and have an idea that's beyond either of the ideas to begin with. That's where the so-called synergy or creativity comes in. But if you're caught up and you got to be right every time and you don't ever want to make a mistake and you can't entertain an idea that's different or novel, you can see that this part gets very constipated, to use a GI word. Okay? You with me? And then finally, you include this newness into you. If you practice it long enough, it becomes a part of you, and you can function and will be different. So this, as we go later this afternoon into you becoming more self-aware, if you don't see a value in it, i.e. appreciate it, guess what you're not going to do? You're not going to practice it. You're basically, in your mind, you will dismiss it. So that when we get to the creativity part of how you make this a part of you, you don't even have any interest in doing that. And so you won't even try. But if you do decide that that would be a good thing if I could help it happen, then you begin to look for ways to do it and ultimately pay the price of doing that.